बिल्कुल
बाद में
My dear students, good morning to all. Okay, today I will discuss about the what are the guidelines are used to follow place the nodes on the finite element model and treatment of boundary conditions. So what are the boundary conditions? So what are the methods are used to treat the boundary conditions? Okay, so before that, let me ask some quiz questions. So first question, what are the element characteristics matrices? What are the element characteristics matrices A, B, C, D? Element characteristics matrices. So unmute yourself and answer the question. What are the element characteristics matrices? Number 10, lateral entry. LE10. Please answer the question. The number of participants 79. Out of 79, even one candidate, he doesn't know answer. So option A, in option A, there are the matrices B matrix, stiffness matrix, and D matrix. So where B matrix is strain displacement matrix. So D matrix, D matrix is material property matrix, a material constant matrix or material property matrix. Okay, D is the material property matrix. Okay, is it answered for this question? Yeah. So element characteristics matrices are, so only so stiffness matrix, element stiffness matrix, element load, body force vector, element traction force. These three matrices are called so element characteristics matrices. Okay. So second question, what is the size of the global stiffness matrix? Global stiffness matrix. So if capital N is total number of degrees of freedom on the structure. So what is the size of global stiffness?
Yes, sir.
So third question, what is the size of global displacement vector? N by 1, 1 by n, sir. N by n, 1 by 1.
D, sir.
So here in this question, multiple answers are there. Is it A, B, C, D, or A, B, or C, D? Huh? Multiple answers are there. Meer nenu both A and B and raste C answer ani cheppestunnaru. Kabatti ikkada multiple answers kind ichchanu.
A and C, sir.
C.
No, sir, A and B.
Answer C. N by N is not, it is wrong. Okay. Multiple answers
A and B.
A
and B.
A and B, yes. So A and B are the correct answers, because so now nodal displacement vector, it is always a column matrix. Okay, N by 1 is the size of nodal displacement vector. So in the case of B, option B, Q transpose, so this become row matrix. So Q transpose, it is a row matrix. So 1 by N. It is also a color. Okay. So next to fourth question, what is the size of global load vector? Global load vector.
A and C, sir.
A and C. Yes. A and C. So global load vector is also a column matrix. So next, what is the expression for element body force vector? Element body force vector. Option A, AE LE FE by 2 minus 1, 1.
Yes, sir.
Huh? Answer.
Please, sir.
C, yes. So C is the correct answer. AE LE FE by 2, 1, 1. So what is the expression for B matrix? B matrix.
D's.
D, answer D. 1 by LE, 1, 1, wrong. Answer D is wrong.
C.
Yes, answer C is correct. So B matrix always, sorry. So this is also wrong. C is also wrong. B matrix. So out of A and B, what is the correct answer? Expression for B matrix.
B, sir.
B. So B is also wrong. A is correct. Okay, 1 by LE minus 1, 1. B matrix always row matrix. Seventh question. What is the expression for traction force vector for two node bar element? Traction force vector.
Yes, sir.
Answer ఏంటండి?
D, sir.
Yes, D is correct. E, LE by 2, 1, 1. Traction vector is always column matrix.
Andi. Undandi, amma.
So, what is the expression for element stiffness matrix? Element.
C, sir, C.
C. Yes. AE, EE by LE, 1 minus 1 minus 1, 1. Yes. C is the correct. So, ninth, the global load vector. How it is obtained? Global load vector. How it is obtained?
Yes, sir.
Answer?
Answer, yes, sir.
Yeah, yeah. So, A is also correct. Okay. Here, there are multiple answers. More than one answer.
Option D, sir.
I think all are correct. So, because if the structure subjected by only body force and point loads, so A is correct. If the body is subjected by traction force and point load, so B is correct. So if the body is subjected by both body force and traction force only, no point loads, so this is C is correct. For all forces are acting on the body, so D is correct. Okay. So global load vector, you will get in this way. Summation of body force vector, traction force vector, and point force. Okay, 10th one, the global stiffness matrix, how it is obtained?
C, sir.
C. Okay, C is correct. Summation of element stiffness matrices. So 11th one, If element stiffness matrix for element 1, 5, minus 5, minus 5, 5. So degrees of freedom 1 and 2. And element stiffness matrix for element 2, 10, minus 10, minus 10, 10. Degrees of freedom 2, 3. So what will be the global stiffness matrix?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
C. Yes, sir.
C or B?
B, sir.
Yes, B is correct. So B is the correct answer. So here, so K11, so K11 is 5. So here global, in global stiffness matrix, K11, 5. So K22, see here on element 1, K22 is 5. On element 2, K22 is 10. So 5 plus 10, it is 15. So K33, so on element 2, it is 10. So on element 1, so there is no K33. Okay, so in this way, you have to add the element stiffness. So 12th question, if element body force factor for element 1, 9, 9, for element 2, 15, 15. So traction force for element 1, 4, 4. For element 2, 6, 6. And point load vector, so 0, 100, 0. 1, 2, 3. Degrees of freedom, 1, 2, 3. So what will be the global load vector? Global load vector.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. C,
B, sir. B.
B. B is wrong. B wrong. So another answer.
C, sir.
C. So C is the correct answer. So here, element body force vector for element 1, F1 is equal to 9. On element 2, there is no F1. But on element 1, there is T1 value, 4. So 9 plus 4, 13. Okay. On element 2, there is no T1. So 0. So on element, point load at node 1, 0. So 9 plus 4 plus 0, so 13. So for F2, global load vector element F2, it is 9 plus 15 plus 4 plus 6 plus, so for 100, 6 plus 100. So total 134, F2. So F3, it is 15 plus, F3, 15 plus 6. 15 plus 6 plus 0. 6 plus 0, yes. So C is the correct answer. So 30th question, I think it is a little bit difficult for you. 13, if element stiffness matrix K1 is equal to 50, minus 50, minus 50, 50. Degrees of freedom are 3 and 1 on element 1. So on element 2, for element 2 stiffness matrix 21, minus 21, minus 21, 21. Degrees of freedom 4, 2. So what will be the global stiffness matrix?
Option D, sir.
Option D, none. ఎంత కష్టపడి క్వశ్చన్ ఫ్రేమ్ చేసి నన్ను అంటానా ఏంటి ఆప్షన్ డి నన్నని ఫ్రేమ్ చేస్తానే ఏంటి సో డి ఇస్ రాంగ్ ఓకే సో టోటల్ నెంబర్ ఆఫ్ డిగ్రీస్ ఆఫ్ ఫ్రీడమ్ ఇన్ దిస్ ప్రాబ్లమ్ హౌ మెనీ టోటల్ నెంబర్ ఆఫ్ డిగ్రీస్ ఆఫ్ ఫ్రీడమ్
ఫోర్ సార్
4, 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, So size of the global stiffness matrix, it is 4x4 matrix. Okay. Degrees of freedom, but on elements are in random order. So not in sequential order. They are in random order. So 3 and 1 on element 1, 4 and 2 are on element 2. So first you observe the diagonal elements, whether they are correct or not. Okay. So K11, it is 50. Okay. K11, 50. So
option B, sir.
Option B.
B.
Option B. Okay. Option B. Okay. K11, 50. So K22 is 21. Yes. 21. K33, 50. Okay. K44, 21. Oh, yeah. So option B, let me check one more element in this matrix. So what is this K31? So this is K31. So K31, so this is K31, minus 50, yes, minus 50. So symmetric, so this matrix is also symmetric. So B is correct, okay. Okay, good. Okay, so what are the guidelines for placing the nodes in FE model? So we have to follow these guidelines while giving the node numbers on FE model. So in one-dimensional problems, so the object is a one-dimensional body. That one-dimensional body, it is represented as a line segment in FE model. So that line segment, when we discretize it, it is divided into short line segments. Okay, shorter line segments. So by using nodes. Okay, so in general, so nodes are usually numbered as a consecutively from left to right. So in a sequential order, so from left to right, we are giving the node numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, 4, 5, 6, 7, so on. Okay. So as are the elements. Okay. So here, I want to explain some guidelines to locate the node numbers, to give the node numbers on FE model. Okay. So there are some rules you have to follow to place the nodes. So the first one, so we must give a node at the support end. So wherever the support on the structure, so where there we should give one node, and also a node must be given at the free end of the boundary. At the free end of the boundary, also we should give one node. And third rule is place a node at the point where the concentrated load, is applied. Concentrated load. So this is wrong. Concentrated A. Concentrated load. So where the concentrated load is applied, so we have to take, we have to place a node. And fourth rule is place a node wherever the cross-sectional area changes or change. So there we should give a node. And the fifth rule is, so wherever the numerical value of the displacement you need, so at that point, you have to give a node. So these are the five rules we have to follow when you are modeling the structure. So for example, this is a structure. So let me make a notes on this structure. Okay, so using above guidelines, we have to model this structure. So at the support end, we have to provide a node, node 1. And so here at one node, at the point where the load is acting, P1, so here also one node. So here at this juncture, so there is a cross-sectional area changes. So at this point, we have to provide a node. And so here at this juncture, there is a cross-sectional chain, area cross-sectional chain. And also at this point, there is a concentrated load P2 is acting. So here we have to consider one node. At the free end of the structure, we have to provide a node. Suppose if I want a displacement value at the middle of this cross section, this stepped bar at this point, so where we have to provide a node. Okay, so these are the locations of the nodes on this structure. So now you give the node numbers in a sequential order from left to right. So at the fixed support, the node is 1. So this is 2, this is 3, 4, 5, 6. So in this way, you have to model the structure. So in between node 1 and 2, so this is element, this is called element 1. Between 2 and 3, so this part is element 2, element 3. Between 4 and 5, element 4. Between 5 and 6, element 5. So total elements are 5, total nodes are 6. So it is a one-dimensional problem. So each node has 1 degree of freedom. Total number of degrees of freedom on this structure are 6. So now let us discuss treatment of boundary conditions. So what are the boundary conditions? So boundary conditions are two types, which are specified displacement boundary conditions and multi-point boundary conditions. Okay. So specified displacement boundary conditions is nothing but at the boundary of the structure, so where we have to specify the value of the displacement. So that is known as the specified displacement boundary. So there are on some structures, there are multiple, more than one specified one, there are multiple boundary conditions. So these are the types of boundary conditions. We have to treat them. Okay. Okay. So in this topic, treatment of boundary conditions. So my objective is how to incorporate boundary conditions in finite element relations. So while incorporating the boundary conditions over a finite element relation, if we wrongly incorporate the boundary conditions on the point in a finite element relation, so we may get wrong results. Okay. So while incorporating boundary conditions, we have to be very careful to incorporate the boundary conditions in your finite element relations. So what boundary conditions, what they do on the structure. So boundary conditions which are actually, so hold the structure in a static position. And also, we may also define it. So boundary conditions, they eliminate the possibility of the structure moving as a rigid structure. So moving as a rigid structure, rigid body. Okay. So it boundary conditions which hold the structure firmly in a static position. And also, in the procedure steps of finite element method, there are so there is a step 3. There is a step 3 in which, so there is a standard finite element equation. So global stiffness matrix K into global displacement vector Q is equal to global load vector F. Okay. So at this juncture of finite element method, so at particularly in this step, so the global stiffness matrix, it is a symmetric matrix and a singular matrix, and also a singular matrix. So whenever it is a singular matrix, its det always is equal to 0. Its det always equal to 0. So here in this equation, global stiffness matrix is a known matrix, and global load vector is also a known matrix. So our objective is to find the global displacement vector. Okay. See, if I want to take this K to this right side of this equation, so it will become inverse matrix. It will become inverse matrix. So while calculating the inverse matrix, we need to take the determinant of that matrix. So that determinant, so inverse of this K matrix, so K inverse is equal to, it is 1 by det K. 1 by det K. Global load vector, adjoint K into global load vector. So adjoint K. So 1 by det K. So when det K is equal to 0, 1 by 0, it is infinity. So here at this point, there is no use of calculating the nodal global displacement vector. Okay. So when we incorporate the boundary conditions, so our finite element relations, so the singularity of the stiffness matrix will be disturbed. Okay, the singularity matrix of the global stiffness matrix will be disturbed. I mean, some of the rows and columns can be eliminated from the global stiffness matrix. So therefore, and the global stiffness will no longer maintain the singularity property. Okay. So when it is in no longer as a singular matrix, then we can find the global displacement vector, and also you can find the inverse of the global stiffness matrix. Okay. So let us discuss what are the specified displacement boundaries. So for example, if I consider a structure which has supported points at R points P1, P2, and so on, PR. At these points, the structure is supported. Okay, P1, P2, so on, PR. And the displacements are specified. So out of these, at these points, the specified displacements are QP1 is equal to A1, QP2 is equal to A2, and so on, QPR is equal to AR. Okay, so A1, A2, AR are the specified values, specified displacement values along the degrees of freedoms P1, P2, so on, PR. Okay. So for example, if you consider a small structure, which is a uniform rod, it is supported by it is supported at both ends. It is supported at both ends. So let us assume supported points at P1 and P2. P1, P2 are the supported points. So at point P1, so there is a displacement 2P1. It is specified as A1 in general. It is specified as A1 in general. So as usual at the supports, the value of A1 specified displacement is equal to 0. So A1 is equal to 0. Say at the support point P2, so there is a QP2 is equal to A2, so A2 is equal to 0. Okay. So similarly, another example, it is also a uniform rod. It is supported at one end. It has fixed support at one end. At the other end, there is a support, but there is a gap in between structure and the support point. Okay. So that gap is, let us assume, 2 mm. Okay. So at the point P1, the specified displacement Q1 is equal to A1 is equal to 0. But at the point P2, there is a specified displacement A2 is equal to 2 mm. So A2 is equal to 2 mm. So A2 is equal to 2 mm. So there are two methods to handle the boundary conditions in a finite element method. So one is elimination approach and the another is penalty approach. Okay. So in this class, I will discuss elimination approach, how to by using elimination approach. So how do we incorporate the boundary conditions on the structure? Okay. So elimination approach. So let us consider a structure so which is having a single support at node 1. So let us assume it's a specified displacement at node 1, Q1 is equal to A1. Q1 is equal to A1. And this structure has total number of degrees of freedom capital N. The structure has total number of degrees of freedom capital N. Okay, so therefore, so global displacement vector, it is Q1, Q2, so on, so on here, Qn. Okay. Global displacement vector. So global load vector, it is F1, F2, so on, so on, Fn. So global stiffness matrix. It is N by N matrix. N by N matrix. So these are the elements in this global stiffness matrix. So therefore, the potential energy of the structure, it is 1 by 2 Q transpose K Q minus Q transpose F. Okay. So this energy equation in general, it is denoted as like this, total potential energy equation. So now, writing this equation in an expanded form, so it means that, so you multiply the matrices, Q transpose K Q, three matrices multiplication, and at this Q transpose multiplied with global load vector F. Okay. So in an expanded form, the total potential energy equation, so 1 by 2 into, so first row of elements of this stiffness matrix K11, K12, K so on, K1n. So first row of stiffness elements are multiplied with the nodal displacements Q1, K11, Q1 plus Q1, K12, Q2. plus, so next term is, so Q3. So on, so on. So last term in this first row of stiffness elements, Q1, K1, and QL. Okay. So similarly, so second row elements of stiffness matrix multiplied with the displacements Q2 into K21, Q1 plus Q2 into K22, Q2 plus so on so on Q2 K2N QN. Okay. So in this way you have to multiply all the elements of stiffness matrix. So nth row elements in stiffness matrix, Qn into KN1 QN Q1 plus Qn KN2 Q2 plus so on so on Qn KNN QN. So minus work potential due to forces. So Q1 F1 plus Q2 F2 plus so on plus Qn Fn. So this is the expanded form of total potential energy. Okay. So now you substitute the boundary condition at node 1, Q1 is equal to UA1 into total potential energy equation. So just simply you substitute, so at Q1 is equal to A1 in the energy equation, 1 by 2 A1 K11 A1 plus A1 K12 Q2 plus once on A1 K1N Qn. Okay, so in these all terms, so A1 is a constant value, so all terms are having this constant value A1. So along the column elements of the stiffness matrix, so there are constant value A1 in all terms. So Q2, K21, A1. So here Q3, K31, A1. So on and so on. The last term, nth term in this column, Qn, KN1, A1. Okay. So in these terms, all terms are having constant value A1. Okay. So rest of the elements are having nodal displacements and stiffness values. Okay. In this area. And minus work potential due to forces, A1 into F1. So only one term, it is having constant value A1. So rest of the terms are having your nodal displacements and loads. Okay. So now, after substituting the value, specified displacement value A1 in the energy equation, it's a constant value. A1 is a constant value. So therefore, the rest of the terms in this energy equation, they are Q2, Q3, Q4, they are the unknown values in that equation. So they are variables. Okay. So after substituting the A1 in the energy equation, total energy equation, it will become the function of variables Q2, Q3, so on, Qn. So now, so in order to get the equilibrium of the entire structure, so here we have to apply the principle of minimum potential energy. So this total potential energy, in order to minimize, we have to differentiate this phi with respect to nodal displacements. Nodal first derivative of the total energy equation dou pi by dou qi is equal to zero. Okay, so you know whenever we differentiate this function with respect to nodal displacement, so this expression will give us n number of algebraic equations. Okay, so where I it is two node two node degrees of freedom two degree of freedom three. So on, so on, degree of freedom n. So therefore, nodal equilibrium equations are finite element equations, so which are obtained by the minimization of the total potential energy equation. Okay, so this is the equation. This is the equilibrium equation at node 2. At node 2. Okay, so this is the equation, equilibrium equation at node 3. So if you observe the terms in this equilibrium equation, so this is this equation is dou pi by dou q2 with respect to q2 is equal to zero. Okay, so if you differentiate this entire equation, energy equation, with respect to q2, so only q2 terms will be remain. So the rest of the terms in this equation will become zero. Okay. So therefore, so this is the equation, equilibrium equation at node 2. So similarly, this is the equation at node 3. So this is the equation at node n, at the last node, at the nth node, this is the equation. So here you observe one more okay, so here F2 minus K21 A1. So this is the, this is actually in this equation, this is actually at left of this equation. So this is here. So K21 A1. Okay, so this is the, this is a constant value. This is a constant value. This value represents the, so load, this value, so stiffness into displacement, it is always a load. So because the stiffness K, it is K is equal to load by deflection. Load by deflection delta. Okay, so you take this K, this term K21 A1 to the right side of this equation. So minus K21 A1. So similarly at node 3, this is K31 A1. At node 4, K41 A1. So at nth node, so this is minus KN1 A1. Okay. So here I am stopping the explanation. Here I am stopping the lecture. Okay. So I will discuss the rest of the things in the next class. It is very, very important this method for solving the finite element problems. Okay, so once again I will explain in the next class this method. So do you have any doubts at this up to this point? If you are not having doubts, I will close the meeting. किशोर राम बाबू
सर
ఎన్నారా ఉన్నారా
ఉన్నాయి
డౌట్స్ ఏమైనా ఉంటే ఏం మాట్లాడరు ఓకే ఎనీవే ఐ హ్యావ్ అనదర్ వర్క్ ప్లీజ్ ఎక్స్క్యూజ్ మీ ఐ విల్ ఎక్స్ప్లెయిన్ ద నెక్స్ట్ వర్క్ థ్యాంక్ యూ వెరీ మచ్
థ్యాంక్ యూ